Hello and welcome to Bialcina 2022. My name is Tara Byrne and I'm the Artistic Director of Bialcina, which is produced by Age&Opportunity. We are Ireland's only festival which celebrates the arts and creativity as we age, bringing all of us over 50 together to tell our stories and to share our stories. So this afternoon, I'm delighted to be welcoming Manchán Magan in conversation with Marian Richardson on his book, 32 Words for Field, Lost Words of the Irish Landscape. And this book explores how the Irish landscape and language are indivisible and can offer entry points to understanding the past. So before I hand over to Manchán and Marian, I'd like to thank them in advance, as well as our literature programmer, Cormac Kinsella, and our core funders, the Arts Council and the HSE. Over to you, Marian and Manchán.
Gurmila Magat Tara, Manchán, Tirets, Kiriwilto, Nach Intach Avebio and Losha.
Dearache Untach Fad Avebio, Shah Marian, Hashed, that's kind to that.
I loved your book, as you know, 32 Words for Field, Lost Words of the Irish Landscape. It's unlike anything I've ever read, Manchán, and it's been a roaring success. Why do you think it's resonated so much?
Yeah, it's such a mystery. I'm 51 now, and it's unlike anything I've ever done before. And despite the fact that I've been involved in the Irish language in loads of different ways for many years, and it's like interesting. In 2007, I think I made a documentary series for RTÉ called No Bearla, going around Ireland just speaking the Irish language. It was always shown on TG Car, but it was made for RTÉ. And when you look back, so I just had to go around Ireland, just speak Irish and see what reactions I got from people. And it was really, it made a big stir, but it was kind of a cynical exploration. You know, it was me seeing, if I spoke Irish, what reaction would I provoke in others? And there was like fear and jealousy and anger and so many different feelings. And at the same year, I think or the year after, Des Bishop had this series, In the Name of the Father, which was a lovely idea. You know, an American educated man goes to Connemara to learn Irish. But that's almost where we were at the time. We had this language and we didn't quite know how to do it. We came at it in a sort of a cynical way or a gimmicky way. And then it just seems that in the last year or two, in the few years, people now want to engage with our culture and our language in a different way. So like I couldn't have written 32 Words for Field 10 years ago. I didn't have the mindset, but I don't think it's just me. I think we're tapping into something bigger. The mindset wasn't there nationally. And now people, possibly because of the, you know, the frightening claims that came out in the last few years about ecology and environmental collapse, or maybe the whole just the sensitivity that happened during COVID when all of people's certainties were suddenly turned awry. And we just thought, wait there, who are we? What are we? So something seems to be rising and it's impossible for me to describe it really.
I'm fascinated by your lineage. I mean, most Irish people can trace their ancestral roots no further back than, say, the early 19th century. But you have a great, 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 great granduncle called Aegon O'Rahalla, a 17th century poet. Tell us about him. Is he an inspiration to you?
Yeah, so, you know, first we need to get our head around what a poet meant in Irish culture. Like the Filla or the Ulluf. The Ulluf was like a really high poet, was a person who had the power of words. And like in all pre-modern cultures, the word was more than just a word. The word could manifest. That's why in the Bible it says, you know, first was the word and then the word was made flesh. So shamanic power uses words to manifest into the world because words are basically their vibrations, their voice vibrations coming out and resonating in the world. And so, you know, the culture that was here before the arrival of St. Patrick understood that perfectly. So the Druid was the main person who could be an intermediary between the other world and this world, and he did it through the word. Now, when St. Patrick came along, you can't have Druids anymore. You can't have Druids and pagan gods who say they can manipulate the world and are in touch with nature when you're trying to disseminate this new view of Christianity. So a lot of the power of the Druids was given to poets. Christians said, yeah, poets can stay, Druids have to go. And so the poets took on a lot of this power. They took on the power to be able to issue curses or to give blessings that would then actually manifest in the world. But it required decades of training to learn this, to learn these skills. And my, as you say, great granduncle four generations back, Aegon O'Rahalla, was one of the last high scholars of this tradition, that goes right back thousands of years into the Druidic tradition. So he was he was, called an Ullav, a professor. And so he was entitled to wear this cloak of crimson feathers, bird feathers, as a sign of his, you can't really use the word shamanic, because shaman is a word connected to another culture, but his sort of supernatural abilities with language and his ability to be an intermediary between this world and the other world. Now, of course, the British had to tamp down on that type of culture, on that type of threat. Christianity had tried to, but the Druids, just by calling themselves poets, had managed to keep it alive. And by, as you say, the 17th century, definitely by the early 18th century, that was all gone. And so Aegon O'Reilly was the last of his lineage, and that went, you know, then like soon after it happened, the flight of the Earls. And so all of the Gaelic lore, the Gaelic tradition left. But luckily, my great granduncle, the O'Reilly, wanted to revive it in the late 19th century, the 1890s. Remember, all over Europe, there was this interest in nationhood and who our roots were. Again, it was a time of turmoil, just like it is now. And whether it was in Zakopane in the south of Poland or in Germany, this new idea, who are we actually? And they reconnected with their myths. And we did the same in Ireland. And as I said, my great granduncle, the O'Reilly, was one of the key protagonists. Well, I should say, he and his two sisters, Áine and Nell, were equally so. They were all founding members of Conor Nugelg, of the Gaelic League. And so that was that side of it, of taking back the language, taking back the culture. But then the O'Reilly went a step further, my great granduncle, by founding the Irish Volunteers in 1913. That's Rowan McNeill.
Well, as you mentioned there, your family was prominent in the nationalist movement in the 19th and the 20th century. As you said there, the Gaelic Revival, of course, the Easter Rising with the O'Reilly, the Civil War. But this love of Irish and the Saol Gaelic in West Kerry all began with your granny, Sheila Humphreys. I met her several times with Maura Comerford, and she was, as they say in French, formidable.
She was a potent woman. Yeah, she was a small woman. I call her now like a terrier, a little rebel terrier, and that's probably unfair. She was this passionate woman. When I knew her, she was a small woman, but so agile. Like she was whenever she'd drive her car, she wore these leather driving gloves, and she drove an NSU, a little Austrian rally car. So she was this cool young, you know, cool woman when I knew, but she was elderly. But it seems that she was very, very beautiful when she was young. And she was just born with this spirit, this spark, like the sort of image we have of Maud Gonne, I think. She just wanted to immerse herself in Irish language and to fight for the independence that would allow then the Irish language and the Irish culture thrive. But for me, you know, I was just this young boy in awe of this powerful woman who decided she was going to mold me and my two brothers and my sister in every way she could. And a lot of that was by making sure we spent as much time in West Kerry as we could. So my mum and dad, you know, my dad was a radiologist. He was busy, and my mum had other sort of concerns. So my granny would just take us down to West Kerry every June and put us into the local school. And then we'd spend more time. We'd spend the next 2 months down there with my family. But she just knew that we needed to be immersed in West Kerry, because for her, the most important thing in her life was her time in the Blasket Islands. So in the year 1909, the O'Reilly decided he was going to bring himself and his four kids and his wife and his two sisters and his two sisters' children, who were my granny and my granduncles, all down to West Kerry, all down to the Blasket Islands. And they basically slept on the floor of Pengsayers and Tommaso Crihan and the king of the island, and just immersed themselves in that way of life, in like collecting seagull eggs by climbing down the cliffs and going out to slaughter seals and collecting turf from the mountainside. And for my granny, I suppose, you know, part of her life in Limerick. So she had a driver, you know, and she had a maid, and she had a nanny, and she had a French, what do you call it? An educator, a governess, a French governess. So to be able to go to the Blaskets and be absolutely live this wild life. And as I said, she seemed to have been a bit of a terrier anyway. That lit a spark in her, and she was determined to give us the freedom of West Kerry, but not only the physical freedom of running along the shore and meeting with the other farmers, but the mental freedom that comes with the Irish language and the mythology that goes with it.
she was also, just to go back to Sheila Humphreys, because I think she's really fascinating. I mean, she was a vice president of Come on the Man at one stage. She got 3 years in prison, 31 days on hunger strike, and committed all her life to that whole ideal of an independent Irish-speaking nation. Would you think it's fair to say that she used the language as a weapon of war to as she would think, achieve national independence?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, for her, yeah, she was so driven and so spirited. So it just disgusted her to think that the Irish people were being colonized, were still being controlled by someone else. So everything was, she was willing to do anything to free Ireland. So she founded an organization called Ghosts, which was a jury intimidation group in the 1930s. So in the late 20s. So if an IRA man was up in front of the courts, they would have a meeting. They would have a knock on the door. The family, the wife and kids, would have a knock on the door late at night from my granny and some people just saying, we know where you live. We can do things to you. For someone who's a witness to a crime done by the IRA. So she was a terrier in every single way. And for her, she adored the Irish language. She adored the culture of it. She adored West Kerry. But she also realized that these could be almost bullets used against the British government. She said it was never against the people of England. She had absolute support for those. And particularly like in the during the Arthur Scargill and the coal miners when I was growing up. But she just hated the fact that Britain, the British government, still controlled Northern Ireland when I was young. But obviously when she was young, controlled the whole of Ireland. And she thought that speaking the Irish language, which the British had tried to wipe out over centuries, was, as you said, another act of aggression. Each word like a bullet aimed straight at the king or the queen, as it was.
Well, and life with her was never boring. I know when you were growing up and when her eyesight was failing, she used to get you to help with communications with the hunger strikers.
Yeah. So, you know, for her... So like this tales of the O'Reilly when he was in 1916, when he was up in the GPO, Garrett writes about that. No, his father, Garrett Fitzgerald's father, Desmond Fitzgerald, says that a few times there were some eager young potshots up in the GPO on the second floor. And they said, oh, I see a British soldier. Can I shoot him? Can I shoot him? And the O'Reilly said, look, you'll just miss and you'll do harm to yourself. The O'Reilly didn't have that same bloodlust. And like during the massacre that happened after the whole gun running in 1914 along just by the O'Connell Bridge there, not called Beggars Bridge, along the Quay, Bachelor's Walk, he was, you know, a lot of people said, go out and shoot and revenge. And he said, no, he was very pacifist in that way, placid. But my granny would always sort of shoot first, as I have a sense. So she obviously continued that struggle. Like she saw that what the IRA were doing in Northern Ireland was a direct continuation of what she had done all her life in the 20s, the 30s. And so she supported them. And so I remember when Bobby Sands first went on hunger strike, my granny said, she packed her bag. And she said, okay, I'm going up, I'm going to go on hunger strike outside the jail of Long Kesh, of the H block. Until my mum banned her. My mum said no. My mum just took the suitcase away. I remember she had this lovely little pretty red suitcase from the 1940s. She had it all packed up and ready. And she said, I'll have my radio with me and I have batteries. I'll be able to listen to Gay Byrne. I'll be fine. And my mum had to say, no, you're not getting into your car. You're not being able to go. Like at one time, my granny, she was the only person who had to do the full lockdown of... of the H block. And I think particularly because this is Bealtaine, a festival, an active aging festival, it's worth talking about that my granny used to go up and see different prisoners. There was a Donough McNellis was one of them. And at one time she went up and she used to try and send letters and books in Irish to Donough and to the other prisoners who were learning Irish in the H block. But they never get through because the prison officers wouldn't understand the Irish language, or they just think that this is confiscate, this is illegal material because it's in Irish, and confiscation. So my granny and the other wives and daughters and, you know, girlfriends of the prisoners go into the prison to meet them. And they're strictly counted in, you know, and they go through gate after gate after gate until eventually they get into the centre. And then they have their visit and they come out again, and the prison wardens count the you know, the visitors, and they realise one is missing. And like, you cannot have suddenly a prisoner, a guest visitor missing in a prison. So the whole thing went into lockdown. Searchlights came on, sirens came on. Everything was just gates locked everywhere until they realized what had happened to the missing visitor. And eventually, about 2 or 3 hours later, they found her in the post room, in the mail room, basically haranguing the British prison officers, telling them why they don't accept her letters in Irish, and teaching them the words that they needed to understand the Irish language, the address in the Irish language.
And so, she used to hide maize escapees on the runs in her granny flat in your childhood home in Donnybrook, and your own father wasn't best pleased.
No, there was no end. For her, every moment was just a step towards both continual Irish freedom for the whole island and then this revival and rejuvenation of the Irish language. And as you said, even if it meant getting her 12-year-old grandson to write out these little letters to the prisoners on the little Rizla papers, these little comms that went back and forth, or to read them, that they were, you know, they'd be smuggled out of the prison, these little letters in Irish, and smuggled in someone's body or in someone's some orifice, and then would be eventually make it down to Dublin, and my granny wouldn't be able to read them, so she'd get me to read them. Everything was in service of the mission of the cause.
So you spent 4 months of every year in West Kerry with your granny, and she used to bribe yourself and your brother Ruan with sweets and money to learn new Irish words. Perfect.
Yeah, I mean, as you said, as we've established, anything was worth doing for the cause. And it was just so important to her that me and Ruan and Riach and Liad and the whole family would be fluent in Irish. And like, so she'd bring us around local islanders, local sort of people's houses, but particularly people from the Blasket Island, because she just thought their Irish was so beautiful. And I remember if someone said like, someone said on the gym, she'd make them say it again and again, just so they would hear. She'd say, Aberisha, Aberisha, and then she'd tell us, say just as you heard the person say it. And we'd say, Ungrian, with our Dublin four accents. She'd say, no, on gym, until we had it right. She was meticulous and passionate, like she was zealous.
So she used to also bring you round with the former Blasket Islanders, people like Coach Ní Cathán. And you say in your book that Coach Ní Cathán said to you, Tamínach na Farriga Umat. What did that mean to you as a little boy? What was that about?
Like, so Coach Ní Cathán was interesting. She was, the daughter of a Blasket Islander, went, as so many of them did, to Springfield, Massachusetts, worked as a baking assistant there. And of course, she couldn't have a name like Coach Ní Cathán over there. She was Kate Kane. Kate Kane. When she came back to Maria, she was Kate Kane. But my granny always insisted on calling her Coach Ní Cathán. It was their given name, and she wanted to re-magic the name that she was, Coach Ní Cathán. And so Coach Ní Cathán just had so much love for us. So we were just, you know, 5 or 6 at the time. And it was just this woman who'd say, oh, my vuchlin bon, my vuchlin bon. And I first thought that was white boy, but of course, bon also means beautiful or lovely. So, and she'd have these. And she said, oh, Tom Mianach na Farigarnat. And Mianach means the essence of the sea, of the Fariga. Now, when I was 5 or 6, I had no idea what she was saying, but I just felt, the love she had for us. And I felt, it's hard to say, I felt she had this lineage. There was something different about her. And I didn't realize she was from that group of people on the island who were almost the last people to live an entirely self-sufficient hunter-gatherer life on the island. You know, they were entirely dependent on themselves in the Blasket Islands. They'd have their own turf, they'd collect their own salvage, flotsam, whatever came in on the seas. They'd kill seals, they'd kill mackerel when it was there. And so they had, the only time that I realized quite how I was getting, quite how potent that connection those people had, the ex-Blasket Islanders had, was when I was on an island off Taiwan called Lanyu Island with the Yami people, like 20, 30 years later, making a T.G. Carr documentary. And again, there were people on this island who were entirely self-sufficient. There would be these hurricanes or tornadoes that hit Lanyu Island, which is 90 miles off the coast of Taiwan, every winter. And so they had to live underground in these caves. And at some point, one of the elders, Shapan Matenan, sang me a song. And he said, this is a song of the creation myth of our people, he said. And you have no connection to me, and I don't to you, but we're all probably coastal people. And when he sang those songs, I remember the songs that Coit and others used to sing, the Blasket Islanders. And I realized, God, that's what Sheila, that's what my granny was trying to connect us to, that there is this lineage that's beyond just nationalism. And that's why Sheila, I believe, wanted freedom from England. It wasn't some small parochial sense of nationalism. It was so that we could express our sovereignty and thus our interconnection with all other people. And the reason I say that, that's in some way a romantic leap, because for my granny, it wasn't about nationalism. It was about socialism. She was, I call her a Republican revolution, but a revolutionary. She was actually a socialist revolution. She was only fighting so that the land of Ireland would belong to all the people of Ireland, and in a way to all the people of the world, just almost like a Native American concept.
So your granny made sure that you were immersed in one of the purest sources of Irish that still existed. I mean, what riches, and such a different way of life as well, but also a different way of perceiving life. I mean, you use a conversation with your granny to open your book, 32 Words for Field, and you asked her the word for whole, and she gave you several possibilities.
Yeah. Like, and again, I suppose what she was trying to show me was that there is this wealth of difference between Irish and English. So that, you know, in Irish, you can say like a cloch for a hole, or you can say like a powl for a hole. But puhish would be a hole that a monster, a wild monster lives in. And then you'd have there's a particular word for a hole in which is made by the hoof of an animal. And then that hoof of the animal gets filled up with water. But she did the same with us with stones. She had like so many words for stone, like Kailach was a witch, you know, but it's also a stone used as an anchor, according to her. But then I've heard that word used by Newfoundland fishermen since. They call it the same, a Kailach. Kavas is a stepping stone, then Kite is a binding stone, then Boshlach is a flat stone, particularly on the side of a stream where clothes would have been washed. So I think she was trying to show us that, yes, you're listening to the English language on BBC and you're reading it in The Observer and all and in the papers at home, but there is you have this connection to this other lineage that is so, because we've been on the island for 2,500 years, we are rooted to every single natural element in it in a profound way. And I think that was what she really wanted to convey to me.
Your book was six years in the making. It's basically a love letter writing to Kirk Aguina. Tell us about some of the 32 words for field and how they differ. And what does that language tell us about the way Irish agrarian life is organized before we were colonized?
Yeah. So if I was rewriting the book now, I'd add one extra element to it, but I'll touch on that in a second. So like as you said, we in English have the word field. I presume we have pasture or meadow as well. But like in Irish, field is gurt, but a field in West Kerry is gurt, in Connemara would be more like park, but gurt is actually a field of full grown corn or grain, as opposed to gaur, which is a field of young grain. Actually, there's a better definition of gurt. Gurt is a field that's capable of being ploughed by two oxen within one day. And to understand that, you have to understand the whole idea of cummer. And cummer means taking a field and agreeing to work in partnership with a neighbour, in which you share the ploughing and the harvesting of the work, as long as all of that can be done between dawn and dusk. And that sort of defines the perimeters and the size and the shape of a gurt. And that'll be different then from a tour, which is a night field for cattle, or rean, which is an upland field, or machara, which is an open field, or maonair, which is an enclosed field, or mean, which is a smooth field, or raedan, which is a field for games or dancing, or plosog, which is a field made level by years of dancing, or taunach, which is an arable field in an arid area. I could go on. But what I have learned since, in the last 2 years of COVID, while doing talks with different Native American people, is that there's great profundity in the Irish language, and definitely spiritual profundity, which we might touch on later. But in terms of these words for stone and holes and fields particularly, they're all about how man can manipulate the earth. As you say, the key thing in your question was agrarian. We are an agrarian people. We are Indo-European people who brought the knowledge of farming with us. First the Neolithic people who built the like of Newgrange, that's not us, we're the Bronze Age people, but we brought more sophisticated methods of farming, of growing grain and tending cattle. And we've been doing that on the island for the last 4,500 years. So it's no surprise that our whole Weltanschauung, our whole worldview is about how we can exploit and manipulate the land. And when I'm giving talks, with me saying my nice ideas and then Native American people, they start in a completely different way, because people who are still mixing hunter-gathering methods with farming have this, you know, they don't talk about how the land can be manipulated and used for their good. They just talk about everything is interconnected. There is this multiple verse of different communities. And when they talk about dates, they just talk about, oh, we've been doing this forever. You know, it's, we're sort of a bit trapped in the more Western liminal point of view. But that said, the Irish language is far more freer, far more connected to beautiful things than definitely the newer, more modern languages that we now use.
You've written a lot, Manchán, about the meaning of place names. Many of our place names were anglicised, and obviously losing that connection to the land. I mean, I know Brian Friel wrote about it in Translations. Why do place names matter, do you think?
Because there was a thing in the Seanchas Mór, and the Seanchas Mór is the first collection of the old laws of Ireland. And like it has been, you know, the versions we have are maybe from the 11th century, but it has been shown to go right back. And so all of the lore and all of the laws were contained in the Seanchas Mór. And there's one beautiful line in it. It says, what is the preserving shrine? In other words, how do we keep the memories of the old days long ago? Because that was the only importance of the Druids, the only importance of anything was who could remember the past. Because that was so vital to remain, to know the lineage of kings, or to know the different weather forecasts that happened, or to know the beginnings of our people or what had happened long ago. So before writing, and as I said, writing came so late to Ireland, it only came in the 5th century to Ireland. Before that, the idea of memory was key, because that everything your past was preserved in memory. So the big question in Seanchas Mór is, what is the preserving shrine? And it says, easy, it is memory and all that is contained within it. And then it asks the question again, what is the preserving shrine? And it says the answer is, it is land or landscape and all that's in it. So what you get from that is this idea that our memories are contained within the land. And what's meant by that, you see this in Aboriginal cultures, in Native cultures, the memories are in the form of stories, and the stories are connected to different places, because we can't really trust our memories. But when we have a story, an adventure story connected to different places, particularly places, an element in the landscape that never changes. So a glacial rock or a big scar done by a meteor or something on the land, you connect it with these things. And so then all you need to do, the next generation needs to do, is walk those places and say that story, and all of the information comes back again. And so much of our lore was preserved in these places. And there was a whole different discipline connected to this, the Dinn Seanchas. The Dinn Seanchas is the lore of notable places. And it now, when we read it, it sounds like extravagant, ridiculous baroque fairy stories, but that's because we don't understand how to read myth anymore. But if we feel our way into it, there's even like we get to see entire concepts of what happened in Ireland long ago through the place names. So that's one element why these big the ancient place names are important. But then even small place names, like in Mayo, there's a place called Ballin the Briskin near Calm. And again, it means nothing in English, Ballin the Briskin. But in Irish, it's Béal Áthán na Briscáin. And Briscáin is a word for tansy. So Béal Áthán, the mouth of the ford, or Baile, it's either the mouth or the town, Baile, of Áthán, the ford of the Briscáin. Anyone who hears that name in long ago would understand there's Briscáin there, there's tansy there. And tansy was vital for certain reasons. First, if you wrapped it around meat, it preserves the meat entirely, because no insect will land on tansy. So you have, like, it was vital to keep meat, you know, free of germs and maggots during the winter if you wanted to survive. And the tansy was there for it. But not only that, tansy could bring on miscarriage. So for women, there was this whole other folk knowledge for women. They knew if they were in difficulty, if they had a pregnancy that they could not continue with, they knew that there were, if you go to one of the townlands that have this word tansy in it, there is relief there for you. So on so many different levels, even from like all those interesting tweets in the last few years of flooded housing estates in the Midlands of Ireland, and with a name like the swamp or the flood or the wet area in the Irish name, we always knew it was going to swamp. They had encoded that knowledge that in flood years, this area is going to be underwater. They had encoded that in the name. But of course, when we disconnect ourselves from that,
as you say, each place name is like a periscope offering a view of another world. But we all have our favourite place names. I mean, I love Wickenagidaga Hall near Carna. I think that's amazing. Snobbo near Osmuck. What's your favourite or your most surprising place name?
Tell us those the translations of those, because I forget. I have Mick Idarha soil in my book. So what is it?
A pig. It's a pig between two sort of inlets.
Yeah, yeah. Why is that? And the other one I didn't know. Say the other one again.
Snobbo. It's where a cow in Rossmuck would swim up through a river. And that's why it is known as Snobbo.
Wow, right.
Literally.
Yeah.
Pow, swim. Snarf.
Yeah, exactly. That's gorgeous. Still, the more I go around the country, I'm seeing so many sea fins, you know, obviously Siachon Finn McCool, I suppose. And I just love that idea that everywhere where people looked around, they saw this Siachon of Finn, of Finn McCool. Now that sort of, that our understanding of Finn McCool at the moment is just, oh, he's a hero. He's sort of a hunter-gatherer hero who runs through the woods with his followers and after deer. But long ago, people would have seen a lot more, would have understood a lot more about Fionn than that. Because Fionn, you know, we think Fionn means fair, sort of fair-haired Fionn. But what is actually, but and Gwen in Welsh, you know, it's the same, white or fair. But what it actually seems is that the meaning there is, it's not just white or fair, it's transparent. So, you know, the key thing about Fionn McCool is he could see through. He could access the Brathan Fasa, the wisdom of knowledge. He had access to all that knowledge beyond. So the idea of the Fionn, I think it's no doubt he had fair hair and white hair, but it was also that it was transparent, that he could see through the veil into the other world. So when we have all these sea films, they're memories to us that there is this wider, broader world and that we can have access to it. Or there is someone on high in this point looking down on us who has access to the magic world, the bigger world. So it's like, it's so expansive and it takes us out from the small scale travails of our daily life to know that there is this magical being who is seeing everything and it's just above.
Well, speaking of the weird and the wonderful, tell us about your visit to Oin na Gcat, the cave of the cat in Roscommon. I heard this extraordinary podcast that you did where you were chanting. I think it was the Almanac of Ireland.
Okay. Yeah, exactly. So I do for RTÉ, I do this podcast called called RTÉ Radio 1, The Almanac of Ireland. And then we put it out as a podcast as well. We're at the moment, tomorrow, we're starting the next 26 episodes of that. But I had always heard talk about this thing. There was a cave of the goddess, the energy of the deity, of the female goddess was in Ireland and the cave still existed. I have heard that for about 10 years, but I could never get any more information about it. Okay, someone said, oh no, it exists. And then tell me it's somewhere in Roscommon. And for whenever I was heading to Mayo or that direction, I'd always stop and roam around a bit around Roscommon, but I could never find it. And it's almost another example of how there does seem to be something rising up now. There does seem to be a consciousness or an awakening that people are searching for answers, but also answers are being given to us. Forever I'd look for Oin na Gcat. And then I just thought, people told me, you know, it was this cave and the Morrigan, who is this female god in the form of a raven, exists down there. And I was driving back and forth looking for it, and I never found it until eventually, about now a year and a half ago or so, I was coming back from Mayo and I just tried, I mean, I knew it had to be around Rac Crochan, because Rac Crochan is one of the most interesting sites in Ireland. It's the citadel of the kings and queens of Connacht. And the most famous king or queen that was there was Queen Maeve, who began the town called Cuilne, this powerful female entity. And so if you're driving the main road, you know, from Lanesborough or from Longford to Mayo, you go right past this, you go right by Rac Crochan. And you go past Queen Maeve's fort, and the archaeological research in the last few years are showing all of these parade ramps, the remains of in the landscape. So it must have been some huge ritual ceremonies were taking place there. And so all around it are like dozens of other monuments. And I thought, if anywhere, someone had sort of told me, the Oin na Gcat, the cave of the cats, or Oin na Gcat, the cave of the battles is going to be there. I went down a little side road, having gone down every single side road in the area over the years and never found it. Finally, I went down and I found some people in the middle of a field. And I asked them and they said, oh yeah, we're here to see Oin na Gcat. There's a guide who's showing us, but he's in the mouth of the cave. So I decided I am going to return here on my own and experience this. Like I'd always heard this, if you can really enter the womb, the citadel of the female goddess, I want to do it on my own. So I told my girlfriend, and I told the Colette Kinsler, who's the director of the producer of the podcast, the TV, the radio series, that I was going to do this. And they all said, okay, do, but make sure you tell us the moment you're going in, tell us when you get out again. But I decided, no, I wasn't going to do that. And I decided I wasn't going to bring my phone. I was just going to go there on my own and try and experience it, spend as long as I could. And like, it's this tiny hole. No wonder I never found it. You would never in a million years find this thing. It's a field that's at the end of this tiny laneway that has grass growing down the middle of it. And you go into the field and still you're not going to see anything until someone maybe points out to you that there's this tiny hole like a fox den underneath a stone in the bank, in the grass bank with hawthorn bushes growing over it. So I posted myself into that. And then it goes right down. It goes down into this huge, like straight down first. It's through this rocky tunnel and then out, opening out in this massive citadel underground where I spent my time. And if people want to experience it, you can now do it. And the best way to do it is to go to the Rackrahan Visitor Centre in Tulsk in County Roscommon. And the two people who actually brought this cave back to consciousness, back to the knowledge of the people, will regularly lead tours there daily, in fact, down to Ivnagat. So I warn you, don't go down on your own, because it is still, that's a whole limestone cavern system. In theory, the whole thing could flood again. I don't think it has for centuries, but it's vital to be there. Because as you heard from the podcast, it's kind of dangerous. I hit my head very badly a few times.
And the chanting was extraordinary.
Yeah, I mean, you know, as I said, that book, 32 Words for Feel, is thinking what's important about language. And we often dismiss it. Like, definitely music or dance are more interesting forms of communication than talking. But when you're frightened, when you're at a time of uncertainty, you will find yourself singing. Like, whenever you, you know, if you ever cut out in the rain, you start singing just to get over the misery of it. And so just that pure loneliness of being deep, deep underground in a cavern with no one knowing I was there, in absolute blackness, a darkness that I've never experienced before, and I hope I never do again. It is important to sing to make yourself feel safe and secure.
So let's talk about leprechauns, that staple of St. Patrick's Day kitsch. Leprechauns, Nadina Maha, Nahushla, they really are, you say, a genuine part of Irish folklore, along with the fairies and the other supernatural folk.
Yeah. So again, when I was, I'm just back from this 7-week tour of North America done with a show at Ron Exim, and I was meeting different Native American peoples. And they said two things to me that are relevant. The first thing I was saying, that we've lost so much of our female knowledge, our knowledge of herbal ways or of female wisdom. And they said to me, how do you know? How do you know they've lost it? They said, like, people, when they're oppressed, rich cultures, they hide the information. You're a man. You're never going to know the information. And immediately I remembered the Ivnagat. And I remembered how people had whispered to me, mumbled to me, that there was a certain thing as a cave of female energy. But I had never read. There was nothing about it on the internet. There was nothing about it in the books. It was in the lore. There were probably women who've known about it all along. In the same way, we had a great amount of wisdom in Ireland, and now, you know, in the modern age, in the last 50 years, we've lost so much of our connection with the mythic world, with the natural world, with the spirit world. But those Americans who left, those Irish who left for America from the 1850s on, they had all of that, and they kept it alive. In one way, we can see they're not as pure anymore. They've been mixed with American ways. They've lost some of the, but actually, they have some of the consciousness of Ireland that was still in Ireland when their ancestors left. From the 1850s, 1840s onwards. And I think leprechaun is a key idea of them. So as you said, modern Irish people in Dublin, we laugh at the notion of leprechauns. You know, RTÉ would just condemn. We'd never mention the idea of leprechauns unless we were laughing at them. And when the Americans come over and look for their leprechaun hats, or when we look at images of New York and Chicago and St. Patrick's Day with their big leprechauns, we think it's farcical. But yet, it's clear from the school's collection, from this wonderful folklore collection that was taken in the late 1930s in every parish, in every village in Ireland. Sheila de Valera, Eamon de Valera's wife, convinced Eamon de Valera to set up the folklore commission and to send folklorists out to every school, and to get the school teachers then to get every child to go into every community and to collect up the folk and the mythic knowledge of the area. And it was all sent back to Dublin. There's now 500,000 pages of it, and it's all online. And we can see there's well over 350 stories about Leprechaun from every county in Ireland, from every parish in Ireland. So we know that up until the late 30s, we firmly believed in Leprechauns. Older people could tell you which were the families who had dealings with Leprechauns, who had got money from it and what they had done with it, where they had seen Leprechauns. It's just countless accounts of seeing Leprechauns. So we know that up until the late 1930s, it was a part of our culture. Then, like, you know, the 1950s, electricity came in. In the early 70s, we joined the EU and we turned our back on all of those things. But they didn't go away. We just got embarrassed by them. The leprechaun, the idea of these little deities living in nature, connecting nature with us, making being intermediaries between us and the other world, is a profound thing that has nourished us and sustained us for thousands of years. And as I said, in the last, you know, 50 years, we feel we're too educated and too uppity. But one of the great wonders that the Americans did was they kept it alive for us.
Mm. Probably wrecked a little bit by Walt Disney with his Darby O'Gill and the Little People, but that's another story. Other fundamental elements of our belief system and culture have also been lost. And you have an entire chapter in your book on women and witches, including the famous Caoilleach Bearer, and you mentioned the whole notion of women and witches and your concern at the loss of the herbal remedies and the cures and the charms that were practiced by women that were never written down.
Yeah. Like, it just strikes me that, I mean, we are so lucky in Ireland that we have this incredibly rich folklore archive. And a lot of it was focused on the West, the Gaeltachtaí. You know, if I was from Roscommon or Westmead, I'd feel very bereft. You go up to UCD archives and it's all just great stories from the West Kerry and Connemara and Donegal, because that's where it was believed the richest remains of culture were. But the problem is so much of it is male bias. Like the great folklore collectors, Seamus de Largy and others, were all male. And of course they went to the likes of Peg Sayers, but when they went to Peg, there was always either a priest in present, or they were male, or there was other men, or the woman might think, the Shanachy might think that a priest would hear it later. And there was this sense that she just didn't talk about women matters in terms of men, in front of men, and certainly not in front of priests. So there was so much was left unsaid. And the men who were collecting the words didn't even think to ask about the questions about, you know, to do a childbirth or to do a child rearing or to do with even things like diarrhea or breastfeeding or any element of the female gender or female sexuality or female consciousness. We just never thought to ask it. And in the same way as all of those herbal remedies, you know, women herbalists in every culture were known, they were on the outside of the village. They were never fully trusted because they had dealings with the other side. And, you know, there's always been this sense of men being afraid of women, and particularly a powerful woman, a woman who had the chant. Like in Irish society, a woman's curse was so much stronger than a male curse, because a woman was still connected with the goddesses of the land, the deities that were still present. So, in the same way, they knew that they had to keep their knowledge quiet and had to be suspicious, because there were always men out to get them, in the same way with their herbal knowledge. So they weren't going to give it, even if Seamus de Largy had come along with his microphone and asked them for all the herbs, they weren't going to give it. So we know there is this great chasm of what we know about our culture. We know that the women had an incredibly powerful role in Gaelic society, and we can intuit, and still actually we can pick out a lot more from the myths. The myths have been interpreted by late 19th century and early 20th century translators like T.F. O'Rahilly, like my cousin, the first cousin of D. O'Rahilly. But he was a male with a patriarchal viewpoint and a 19th century conditioning. So even Cecil O'Rahilly, his sister, who translated the Táin Bó Cúil, my other cousin, she too, she was a victim of her age. So she would have been sent, like my granny, to a governess, you know, to the elite schools, finishing schools in France. So she wouldn't have been in touch with her own full power. So we just know that there's an awful lot that is lost, but I don't think it's too late. In the same way as, like, during COVID, I did a project called Sea Tamagotchi, reaching out for sea words, went out to fishermen in Mayo, Donegal and Galway, getting these fishing coastal words and sea words from them, and I put them all, I recorded them saying the words audibly, and then I put them all up on my website on manchan.com, the recordings of the fishermen. But it was so easy. The fishermen were like ready and waiting, and it all required just going to any community and asking, who are the old people with the knowledge? And we know that in every community, we know the old people with the knowledge, whether it is here in Westmeath, where I live, or Roscommon, or Longford, or West Kerry. In the same way, there are the women still with some knowledge, with herbal knowledge. Like in this, I just had a TG Carr series on bogs, and I had Margaret Kitty Neve Wheel up in Donegal, who knows so much of the lore of the medicinal plants from bogs. So I recorded her for the TV series, but I made sure to go back 3 weeks later with my audio recorder and record whatever the other words she had. There are women still with female words, with words for the female world, and someone needs to go and record them. And we don't need any special equipment. It just means our little phone, going out and getting the myths. And you'll be surprised. People, as we know, older people want to share their knowledge. So although we're aware of how much we've lost, there is so much still that can be collected if we actively choose to do so.
So you're basically saying the whole new vocabulary exclusive to women is still out there to be collected and preserved.
That, exactly.
That bawdiness, say, that Peg Sayers had. That, yeah. Is that you mentioned at one stage in your book about Nuala Ní Gonail, the poet, that she was, tell me that story.
Yeah, Nuala always thought that, Nuala was born in Northern England, but then spent her whole upbringing, her childhood in West Kerry. And she always thought that there was no words for sexuality in the Irish language. And she was a very sensuous woman, an open woman, and realised she could express all these things in English, but not in Irish, until suddenly she married. And the minute she married, she was invited into the back kitchen with the other women and realised there was a whole different dialogue, a whole different vocabulary that was being used, or a whole different register that was used among women themselves. And so they have the words, but they just aren't going to either embarrass the men by using them, or are definitely not going to say them in front of law bra, in front of prudish Irish language speakers who blush when you talk, as you say, in this earthy, bawdy way. So it's there, but I'm the wrong person to collect it. And, so there's this lovely book that Cushgame published of sexual words from West Kerry, but they were collected by a man from Dublin, and he just asked 3 other men. So all of that is still waiting if anyone just goes down, and the language is there. And no, it's not just the language, it's that awareness, that sensuous, open knowledge of shame-free knowledge of the body and sexuality that is so key for us to get back.
As you say in your book, so many beautiful words have been lost. Words like Ivaroch, for example. What is that word? What does that word mean? What does it conjure up for you?
Yeah, well, I suppose the main thing conjures up is the first time I heard it, the first time my granny said it to me. So Iarbhír, it's basically the loneliness at cockcrow. And so Iarbhír is the morning, but Iarbhír, the loneliness, when you're the first person up in the morning and you just feel that there's no one else alive in the world. And it's a beautiful sereneness, serenity to it. But also there's a sense like, oh, where is everyone? There is this chasm, there is this. So it's a sense, it's just an aliveness. And I remember I got my granny, I had gone up once, I was growing oaks, trying to grow oaks down in the place in West Kerry, because my great grandaunt had planted a lot of trees and they were getting old. And I was just out with the sickle, just trying to cut down the grass. And she saw me and she said that word. But as you said, these words that are rooted to our relationship with nature, and that other word that you and I were talking about earlier, de-lahar, which is basically it's when humans are removed from a land, when humanity and the vibrancy is removed from a place. So basically the destruction that happens when we come in with machines and come in with exploitation and ruin a bit of nature.
You always say you feel like a different person when speaking Irish, and you describe Irish as a language that not only describes things but summons them into being. I love that. What exactly do you mean by that?
Yeah, I mean, they're concepts that we don't so much have anymore, but it seems like our myth, and you know, we're still coming out of an era of facts, and everything has to be fact and everything has to be linear in history. But I think we're coming into realizing that myths do have wisdom. And again, it's been interesting how, you know, archaeologists have looked at the Australia and seen that the Aboriginal people, their myths actually do have knowledge. And now going back to our own myths, we're seeing we have knowledge. But one of the key myths is the first thing the humans arrived in Ireland, when they arrived, Amargin, our first druid, our first magical poet, he basically summoned up the world. He said these words am gwe, am wir, am tun trehem, am dav shach mirand. Basically calling alive everything, the stag with seven tines, the ocean waves, the hawk on the cliff, the flowers, the sparkle of the sun through a dewdrop. All of these words were said and manifested into being. Like, it's a beautiful idea. And it's an idea that you'll find in so many native cultures and primitive tribes, that words reflect, and words have matter in the world. And in fact, it was then chimed again with sort of in the 1980s with this whole idea of mantras and new age, saying things to manifest themselves. But now the new era of mindfulness and the psychology and research done, saying that actually if we do say aphorisms and if we do say potent things, they do actually manifest in the world. There was truth behind this idea that words have impact.
Before you became so well known as an Irish language and heritage expert, you were a travel writer, heading off to Africa and far-flung places in search of whatever. And your brother was often sent out by your mother to rescue you. And that's all in the book. Fabulous stories.
Yeah. And to be fair, what I was doing, I was fleeing my granny. Like, we can say, we've talked about my granny, she was a powerful person. You don't want such a powerful person, such an intimidating presence. I wanted to have my own thoughts. So I ran as far as I could for my granny and the Irish language. And as you say, spent a lot of time in India and South America and Africa until finally I came around to the language again. I would still have questions about my granny's love of violence, but I did need to free myself from her powerful influence.
You're back home now for a while. You live on, is it 10 acres in the Midlands in a house you built yourself?
In some ways it's heaven. So like, I'm just back from this 7-week tour of North America with the show Raw magazine, where I deal with some of the ideas in 32 words for field. And just to be able to decompress on the land is just so gorgeous. I mean, there's the hard part too. So I've been just like the last few days, I've been backbreaking, plowing the land to get the potatoes in. I have the leeks in, I have the onions in, I have a whole polytunnel is up and running again with tomatoes. But I got hens just at the beginning of COVID, and some of them are 2 years old. Some are gonna need to be killed. So there's the dark side too. I'm going to have to kill my first hen in the next few weeks, which will be interesting. But yeah, no, it gives me amazing peace of mind to have my little patch here.
Well, as you say there, you're growing vegetables and presumably you're also back baking bread. And seeing as that you said you've been in the United States and Canada performing a Raw magazine where you bake bread on stage while offering insights into the Irish language. I'm interested to know, what was the reaction from audiences there?
So it was really interesting because I was basically going around the Irish American centers and I'm getting to see the vast difference. There's the Irish American centers where people new Irish people haven't moved in there since the 1980s. So the people are kind of getting elderly and kind of conservative and traditional. And then in other cities, this new generation of Irish people who've just moved over in the last 10 years, were entirely international, still connected with home. So I realized there's just all these different types of Irish Americans there. But what was amazing was I thought I was going to have to water down the ideas. So as you say, I baked the sourdough bread, the audience churned the butter, and I talked about the ideas about the Irish language. And I thought some of the ideas they weren't going to get, particularly because there were people from other cultures going there. But these are international ideas that old languages reveal important elements about our connection with the spirit world and the natural world long ago. So actually it worked better than I thought.
Fantastic. And tell me about your next project or projects.
So in September, I have a new book coming out called Listen to the Land Speak. And basically, if the 32 words for field was looking at the insights that the Irish language gives into ourselves, into our psyche, into the other world, this new book, Listen to the Land Speaks, is looking at what the insights the land gives into ourselves, into our psyche, into the other world, etc. And what I didn't intend it to do, but what it's turned out to be, it's actually just revealing how the deity, the female goddess, is everywhere in the landscape. The mountains and the river. I had no intention that would be a prime concern, but it just, again, it's rising out of us. So I'll be doing that in September, and then I'll be doing another tour of Raw magazine, of the show where I bake the sourdough bread around Ireland in autumn time. And I'll be doing, as I say, another 26 episodes of my almanac, of my podcast for RTÉ Radio, the Almanac of Ireland. So I'll be, and the one other thing I do, I make these little art books with Red Fox Press, and one was with the C words, the coastal words. One was with some of the 4,300 words that are to describe someone's character in Irish. Most of them are negative, and most of them were used at women by other women in a playful way. But I want to do one third little book in these series of handmade books by Red Fox Press about the links between Ireland and Hindu, or in Sanskrit culture, but the Hindu language, the Sanskrit language, and the culture that goes with it. Because there are an uncanny amount of connections, because we both arose from the same bath, the same bed many thousands of years ago.
You said at one stage that you were going to give up flying, that as an environmentalist you couldn't promote travel when you realised the effect on the planet. That'll curtail your activities quite a bit, won't it?
Yeah, so I said in the beginning, at the end of 2019, that I wasn't going to do any travel journalism anymore for flying, and I wasn't going to go on holidays and flight. I did say that I would do my cultural work, I'd still take the odd flight. But at the time I was like, yeah, you said I was the travel journalist on the Sean O'Rourke show, and I was the travel on the 6 o'clock show on TV on Virgin Media and Dave Fanning show. And I thought I could just continue by just taking trains. I thought it'd be a great opportunity. But unfortunately, the producers of most of those shows didn't agree, and they dropped me. But also COVID came along, so no one was traveling anywhere. But I am still now really excited to report on going by trains. So like in February, I spent a month traveling around Brittany by train. And then just before COVID, I went down to the south of Spain, down to Seville by train. So I think there's amazing opportunities. And even so, I flew over to America for this 7-week tour, but the 7-week tour was entirely on land. And so even it involved one 31-hour train journey from New Orleans up to DC. So to show that I think for cultural reasons, it's okay to take a flight now and then, but there's no need to fly for holidays anymore. Mm. There's no need to fly for travel journalism, because there's so many opportunities that we can do by train. Mm. That said, it's easy for me to say that, because I've spent my whole life flying. You know, I've already got it out of me. It's a bit hypocritical to be saying that in front of young people who haven't flown.
Just tell me, before I move on, are you still the dreamy person that you were as a child, do you think?
Entirely so. Yeah, that's why I need this 10 acres. This land here is just where I spend most time in the other world, in that magic world. So I know how to be pragmatic and how to go out into the real world and communicate. Like, it always amazed me how I used to be on your show. I used to be on the Drive Time show with Mary Wilson. And I used to have an article in the Irish Times. And at the time, Marian, you were my producer there. I do a regularly, I think, weekly travel slot. And I think
you were great.
Thank you. But I used to think, when I was having my dealings with you, or having my dealings with Irish Times editors, and thinking, do you have any idea how away with the fairies I am? Like, how can you let me be on the national evening radio show or have an article in the Irish Times when I know how to do both pretty well. And I know some people don't manage that and actually end up in mental institutions. And there was always that opportunity, that chance with me, that actually I'd go too far one side or the other. Like, if I went too far on the rational side, I would just suffocate. I wouldn't be able to do it. I'd commit suicide. And if I go too far in the wild lefty side, then I am no use to anyone. I'm just like sitting on top of a hill chanting and breathing. So it's the balance between the two that's so key.
Well, I could talk to you all day, but I'm afraid the clock has caught up with us, Manchán. And I want to give our audience out there in Zoom land a chance to ask you some questions, and we've lots of them. So first off, Manchán, this person, Elin, wants to talk to you about the demise of the Irish language. Many of the words in your book are now extinct or on the way out, she says. Is that a cause of despair to you? Mm.
Yeah, I mean, definitely the decline of the Gaeltacht is a cause of despair, because that's the source, that's the well source of all the words. But at the same time, the fact that in the last few years, this new passion and interest in the Irish language has to be a source of excitement for me. Like, we've always said the same things about the Irish language. Oh, it was beaten into me as a child, I can't use it. Oh, it's useless in the modern world. Or, oh, the government wastes so much money. We repeat those same things without ever really engaging and exploring the positive elements. In the last 3 years, that has shifted entirely. I have seen so many people trying to re-engage with the language in a new way. And so if we choose to do that, it's not hard to learn a language, particularly a language that people feel when they learn it, that it almost does begin to bubble up again, that it is in somehow in their epigenetics or within the DNA. So I have not lost all hope just because of the signs I've seen the last few years of this turn back towards it.
So you just believe we've been having the wrong conversations about saving the language?
I believe we've been the victims of post-colonial trauma, that we have been so locked down and imprisoned by our own guilt state and our own shame about ourselves and our culture, and the fact that we knew that the Irish language was the one thing that saved, the English language was the one thing that saved us during the famine. By turning away from the Irish language, we had the opportunity to, we got English and we had the opportunity to flee. It was vital. It requires some mental processing for us to get through all that and then to realise actually there's no shame, there's no fear, there's no harm in the Irish language. And I believe that process began in the late 1990s when Ireland began its economic boom.
Here's another one. I think you'll enjoy this one. One of the great joys in life has to be cursing us. It's so satisfying. Could Manchán give us a few blasts there?
No, I mean, I could, but I don't do them as well. When I say them, they sound like a Dublin Four person saying the words, because I wrote them in the book, and sometimes I say them and I just add, they don't sound as good for me. So no, I'm not going to give you any curses. Because we even forget, like, Gnenachan on deal dreamer of the ground was one that the devil may make a ladder of your backbone. But when I say them, they just don't sound, they sound ridiculous. They sound ridiculous.
And this person wants to know, how do we know so much about the early Irish speaking people who arrived here nearly 3,000 years ago?
Yeah.
That would be the monks, wouldn't it?
Not 3,000 years ago. that would be the monks. Yes, exactly. Yeah. So, I mean, in terms of history began in 437 AD when St. Patrick came, because he brought writing and then writing. I mean, that's not the case, because before that, we have accounts of the Celtic people by the likes of Pliny and Julius Caesar, who were exploring from them. But otherwise, it's just archaeologists looking at the remnants of what was there and trying to decipher from that. But we can't know. All we can know is that the Irish language was spoken when St. Patrick arrived, because he wrote about it. From looking back, we see that that was a form of Irish that had been spoken for longer. So we can go back another, St. Patrick, 1,600 years, we can go back to 2,000 years. Then we can probably say, okay, looking at it, looks like it was spoken for 2,500 years. But it's impossible to be certain of any of these things, because archaeology records stone, it doesn't record words.
And here's another one linked to that. The medieval scribes who preserved so much of Gaelic language and culture, were they reliable narrators, or did they bend their stories to suit their own Christian agenda?
Yeah, they so bend their stories. So when this new explanation, if we're going to start looking at myths, it's going to be so hard, because we're looking at it through all sorts of unclear prisms. The prism, as you said, of the monks, who definitely had a bias. The prism of the 19th century translators, who also had their own bias. And then the prism of a folk storytelling tradition does not require factual accuracy. It's about keeping bigger truths rather than ideas like dates or actual things in tune. So a lot of people in a lot of cultures, anthropologists and native people, have explored what myth actually is, how myth is not about a linear account of different things. It deals with bigger truths. And we're going to need to come to understand that with terms of Ireland so that we can really understand and decipher our myths. Clearly, there's a lot of blocks in our way, our own 21st century conditioning, all of the different versions and people who interpret it along the way. But I do believe we can access some core truths in that. And I say that because other cultures have managed to decipher elements of their myth.
And the last question we've time for, you mentioned there earlier, Manchán, about the similarities between Ireland and India found in language. And do we share the same Indo-European origins, this person wants to know?
Yeah, what's interesting is I make a lot of this about our links between Ireland and India. And we could say, but all European countries, almost all European countries are Indo-European countries. So what's more special about the link between Ireland and India? Why do Ireland and India share so much of the same myths? Why are their main, the main myth in Ireland is the town book Cuilna about cattle raiding. The main one in India is the Mahabharata about cattle raiding. So many of our laws are the same. So much of our hierarchical systems, the Brehav and the Ira and the Ri are echoed with even the same words. And so many words are similar in Irish and in Indian. The reason why, or in Sanskrit or Hindu, the reason why there are so many more similarities between Irish and India and Irish and all of the other cultures in Europe and in Western Asia that were also Indo-European is because if you imagine a stone dropping into a pond of water, the ripples move outwards. So Indo-European culture was a culture that was in the area where Europe and Asia meet. Then that ripple moved loads of new different influences came in later in the middle, the Huns, the Goths, the Visigoths, the barbarians, and we on the outside, the ripple remained pure. So that's why in the far west in Ireland and the far east in India, those cultures show more remains of this common Indo-European culture that was once throughout everywhere.
Well, Sinéad, of course, he's sport. It's been great talking to you. Very, very interesting as usual. I look forward to reading your new work out in the autumn.
Exactly. I'm a vila buechas, Marian. I got such a pleasure out of that. That was a real treat.
Slán agri, slán.
Slán, slán mish.
So just to give a huge thanks to Manchán Magan and Marian Richardson for that incredibly interesting and so many nuggets in that conversation. And also to thank all of you for coming here today. And just a reminder that if you're looking for other Bealtaine events, and there are still many more left, please check out bealtaine.ie. And thank you very much.